The F-35A Lightning II is a fifth generation multi-role stealth fighter and is widely considered to be one of the most technologically advanced fighter jets in the world. It's used by several nations around the world, and Australia currently has a fleet of 72 of these aircraft. But is that enough? On the 2nd of March, opposition leader Peter Dutton came strong out of the gates, announcing that if elected, a coalition government would spend $3 billion on acquiring an additional 28 F-35 Joint Strike Fighters. This means that Australia would have another squadron of the most advanced stealth fighters in the world. But what will this acquisition look like? What can the F-35s do? And do we really need more of them? Put your aviator sunnies on and strap yourselves in, because today we're talking tactics. It's election season in Australia. Even though the federal election hasn't been called as of the filming of this video, we know it's coming soon, and it seems like defence is shaping up to be a key issue in the campaign. We've covered a number of defence acquisition projects on the channel, and as mentioned, Peter Dutton has recently announced the coalition's plan to purchase more F-35A Lightning II Joint Strike Fighters if elected. So let's take a look at these aircraft. What is the F-35 and what can it do? The Lockheed Martin F-35 Lightning II, also known as the Joint Strike Fighter, is the cornerstone of the Royal Australian Air Force Combat Fleet. We currently have 72 of these aircraft spread across three squadrons. What we're talking about here is a fifth generation stealth fighter, which is widely considered to be the most advanced combat aircraft in the world. As a multi-role aircraft, it is capable of conducting both air superiority and strike missions, but it also has advanced electronic warfare and reconnaissance capabilities. It was developed by the Joint Strike Fighter Program, a partnership between the US, NATO, and other key allies, such as Australia. The F-35 is primarily US designed, manufactured, and funded, with other countries in the program helping out. There are three main variants of the F-35, with Australia's F-35s currently all being the A variant, which is designed for conventional takeoff and landing on standard runways. The F-35A has a crew of one, a length of 15.7 meters, a wingspan of 11 meters, and a height of 4.4 meters. It has a maximum takeoff weight of almost 30 tons. In terms of performance, the F-35 has a maximum speed of Mach 1.6 at high altitude, or Mach 1.05 at sea level, and a maximum range of 2,800 kilometers, but realistically a combat range of around about half that, depending on the mission. Armaments include a 25 millimeter cannon with 180 rounds. The F-35 has four internal and six external hardpoints. These hardpoints are capable of carrying a variety of bombs, as well as air-to-air and air-to-surface missiles. If a mission needs to emphasize stealth, the F-35 might only carry weapons on its internal hardpoints, which minimizes its radar profile and therefore maximizes its stealth. But if stealth isn't a priority, the F-35 can go into full beast mode, carrying additional weapons on its six external hardpoints. In total, the F-35 is capable of carrying over 8 tons of ordnance if it doesn't need to be sneaking around. The F-35 is also equipped with a number of world-leading avionics packages, including highly advanced targeting and tracking sensors, electronic warfare, and electronic countermeasures, as well as communication systems which allow an F-35 to rapidly share battlefield data with other friendly aircraft in the area. This means that if one F-35 targets enemy aircraft, other friendly aircraft further away might be able to quickly piggyback on the targeting information. The F-35 is expected to go through a number of upgrades throughout its operational life, which is expected to run up until 2070. So that means, yes, this is a platform we want to invest in for the long haul. Who knows, maybe your kids and grandkids might get the chance to fly the F-35 around. But let me know in the comments section what you think drones will replace the F-35s as the apex predator of the skies. The first major upgrade program is Block 4, which is expected to be rolled out over the late 2020s to the early 2030s. This upgrade will allow the F-35 to use a wider range of armaments, as well as improving sensors and avionics hardware. However, perhaps the most exciting element of the upgrade is a new engine system, which will make the F-35 faster and give it longer range via improved fuel efficiency. Other improvements are in development, such as the Sidekick, which is a weapons rack that allows the F-35 to carry an additional 2 missiles in its internal weapons station. Aircraft equipped with the Sidekick will be able to carry up to 6 missiles and still be in full stealth mode. How were the F-35s procured? Australia was an early signatory to the Joint Strike Fighter program, signing up in 2002. As the program progressed, there was a huge amount of debate over the program in Australia. Some of the concerns being raised were legitimate, such as questions about cost overruns and delayed timeframes. Sound familiar? Our AUKUS partnership has faced similar criticism. However, other parts of the debate showed that there was a lack of defence literacy and, in some instances, a willingness to repeat Russian propaganda amongst some Australian journalists and commentators. These journalists and commentators claimed that the 5th generation F-35 would be inferior to 4th generation Russian fighters, such as the Su-27 and Su-30, which supposedly had superior dogfighting capabilities than the F-35. These arguments miss the point that air warfare is evolving. The strengths of the F-35 lie in its ability to avoid detection using its stealth technology, the ability to target enemy aircraft from a distance using its sensor package and destroy them before the enemy even knows the F-35 is nearby. With this in mind, the F-35 is only getting into close dogfights as a last resort. Despite this commentary, successive Australian governments continued with the Joint Strike Fighter program, with the first order of 14 aircraft being placed in 2009. A second order of 58 additional F-35s was placed in 2014, with the Royal Australian Air Force pilots starting training on the F-35s in the US later that year. Australia's 72 F-35s were gradually delivered starting in 2018 and finishing with the final 9 airframes arriving in Australia in December 2024. The total cost of these planes was $17 billion. However, the long-standing plan was for Australia to eventually order another 28 F-35s to replace our F-18F Super Hornets, which were our strike fighter force. But following the release of the Defence Strategic Review in 2023 and the National Defence Strategy in 2024, the Albanese government decided to cancel these plans in favour of maintaining the Super Hornets for longer and diverting the savings into new warships and long-range missiles. The cost-cutting, delays, and reprioritizations of defense spending under Anthony Albanese has amounted to over $80 billion since he came into office. A staggering amount considering our capability gaps. On the 2nd of March 2025, opposition leader Peter Dutton committed to deliver the original plan of buying the final 28 F-35s for $3 billion. The announcement included an aim to have these planes delivered by 2030, although defence experts have already stated that this is quite an optimistic timeframe given ongoing delays in the F-35 production process. But overall, I think it's a good thing that we're going to be getting them soon. The F-35B factor. Peter Dutton has already indicated that the plan for the additional F-35s is for them to be the same A variant as Australia's existing 72 planes. However, another option would be to look at acquiring 28 B variants, which we could modify our 2 Canberra-class amphibious ships to operate, essentially giving Australia mini aircraft carriers. The F-35B is a short takeoff and vertical landing variant, which sacrifices about a third of its fuel capacity for a lift fan, allowing the vertical landing capability. This option was briefly examined in 2014 by the Defence Department and the Australian Strategic Policy Institute, but judged it to be too expensive and not worth the cost of modifying the Canberra-class ships. Still, a lot has changed in the last decade, and providing the Air Force with the flexibility of being able to operate out of 2 rapidly deployable amphibious ships into Australia's north would open up a whole new set of strategic options in the defense of Northern Australia and its approaches. Another YouTuber, Hypo Hysterical History, did a more recent estimate of the costs of upgrading the Canberra-class ships to use the F-35B. He estimated it would only cost $50 million to $100 million to make the upgrades to each ship, compared to the $500 million for each ship estimated by the Australian Strategic Policy Institute. I've linked Hypo Hysterical History's video below, but it seems like it's worth having a detailed look into whether the Air Force would be better served with a whole new capability in the F-35Bs rather than another squadron's worth of F-35As. How will the additional F-35s fit into the RAAF? While the Coalition haven't released too many details of their plan yet, it looks like the election commitment is simply restoring the final phase of the original F-35 acquisition. But maybe this commitment to buy an additional 28 F-35s should be used as an opportunity to start expanding the Air Force. The Super Hornets are still a formidable aircraft with powerful long-range strike capabilities, particularly if they're upgraded to the latest Block 3 configuration, which will upgrade their avionics packages to something approaching the F-35's capabilities, as well as improving their airframe's durability. Retaining and upgrading the Super Hornets would allow them to make a meaningful contribution to Australia's defence up until at least the current retirement date of sometime in the mid-2030s. And it gives us enough time to get the additional squadron of F-35s. Why is there reluctance to buy additional F-35s and keep the Super Hornets? The Royal Australian Air Force has had a soft limit of around 100 combat planes for decades, but it's probably time we started moving away from that arbitrary number. With the increase of geopolitical tensions in both our region and the rest of the world, it's time to start building up the number of our combat aircraft. If we did find ourselves in a potential conflict, any losses of airframes would be extremely hard to replace, as we can't build them locally and timeframes for overseas orders would likely be extremely long. If the next major conflict Australia is involved in lasts years, we might not receive any replacement aircraft for the whole duration of the conflict. And while conflict often feels like it's highly unlikely, in February this year, Australia had a bit of a wake-up call when a flotilla of Chinese warships sailed around Australia, coming less than 300 kilometres away from Sydney and conducting a live fire exercise which disrupted air traffic. It was a timely reminder that Australia needs an air force large enough to credibly protect Australia's massive coastline and deter potential adversaries. On the 4th of March, Prime Minister Anthony Albanese suggested he was open to sending Australian troops to Ukraine in response to President Trump's fiery meeting in the Oval Office with President Zelensky. Personally, I think we've got bigger problems in our own home region. We should be focusing our efforts on preparing our country, particularly when we need Virgin Airlines pilots to identify Chinese warships off our coast and our own radar systems failed to know what even happened. Speaking of defending against Chinese warships off the Australian coast, the Super Hornets also have the advantage of already having integrated AGM-158C long-range anti-ship missiles for use while the F-35 is still in the process of integrating it. This missile is one of the Air Force's key new anti-ship strike capabilities, capable of hitting ships from 370 kilometers, meaning that the Super Hornets could have theoretically sunk these warships while flying directly over Sydney. This is another factor we should keep in mind when deciding whether to retire the Super Hornets. In my opinion, I think it displays utter weakness on behalf of the government that we did nothing in response to the Chinese warships off our coast, even after live fire exercises. We should have responded by sending flyovers of F-35s and Super Hornets in the vicinity of the flotilla and asserted Australian control over our maritime waters. A Collins-class submarine should have been deployed to monitor movements and send a strong but subtle message. And Australian warships like our Hobart-class destroyers or Anzac-class frigates to shadow and escort the Chinese vessels. China has had no shortage of bullying and intimidation tactics of its own, with a Chinese destroyer nearly colliding with a US Navy ship, or jammed GPS signals and communications of commercial and military vessels, using water cannons and blockades, or engaging in close proximity maneuvers to bully and intimidate. We chose to do nothing. Absolutely weak on behalf of Albo. Instead, he'd rather send troops to Ukraine when what he should be doing is protecting Australia's coastline. But what do you think? The Coalition's announcement has given us a lot to think about. What do you think about Peter Dutton's plan to acquire another 28 F-35s? And if we do, should we retain the Super Hornets as well? Is it worth having another look at the F-35Bs and the possibility of converting the Canberra class to be able to deploy them? Do you want mini aircraft carriers for Australia? Should we be sending troops over to Ukraine or focus on shoring up our own region first? And with those Chinese warships having sailed around Australia, do you think defence initiatives should receive more attention in the upcoming federal election campaign? As always, I'd love to know your thoughts in the comments section down below. I'm trying really hard to grow my subscriber numbers. My ad revenue is set to the lowest possible level, giving you more content to watch with less ads. I'd really appreciate if you could hit that like and subscribe button to show your support and share the video with a friend. But that's it for today. My name's Mel Pikos, and we've been talking tactics.